Good evening, everyone. We're so glad that you could join us. We realize that this is a very difficult topic for some of us, and it can be triggering also for us. But, you know, we ask you to take care of yourself tonight. We ask you to be sure that if you are triggered in any way or feeling threatened or whatever with memories, please step away, get a drink of water, call a friend, do what you need to do to take care of yourself. Our first concern is we do not want to cause more harm to you. We realize enough has been done to each of you, but we welcome you and the courage that it takes to be here tonight. I'd like to introduce our presenters to you. First, we have Dr. Mark Lavand, a sexuality educator and researcher working at the intersection of sexuality and Roman Catholic theology. He is an AASECT certified sexuality educator and supervisor, training future sexuality educators through academic programs at Widener University and the Sexual Health Certificate Program at the University of Michigan. As a part of his work, Dr. Lavand teaches human sexuality courses at many different colleges and universities and conducts professional trainings to increase sensitivity towards sexual differences, self-reflective sexuality, and the intersection of sexuality, personal faith, and religion. In addition to sexuality courses, he teaches education methods, theology and religious studies, counseling sensitivity, and research methods. We welcome you, Mark. Father Jerry McGlone is a senior research fellow at the Berkley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs at Georgetown University. He is a survivor of clerical sexual abuse, adult sexual misconduct, and harassment. He has been clinical director and executive director of various treatment centers for religious and clergy in the United States. He is the author of numerous peer-reviewed articles, chapters, and two award-winning books, The Inner Life of Priests and To Be One in Christ, Intercultural Formation and Ministry. He has also authored several sexual abuse prevention programs in the church and religious orders. His new book, When Faith Rooms, will be published with Georgetown University Press. Welcome, Jerry. We're glad to have both of you here tonight. The floor is yours.
Awesome. Thanks, Paula. Welcome, everyone. I'm going to share screen so we can have a visual aid for tonight. And then I know sometimes Zoom lags, so I'm going to wait. Jerry, Paula, do you see the screen up?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it looks wonderful.
Awesome.
And yes, awesome. Just to answer a question that's already come up, I think everyone is already muted, right, Paula?
Yes, they are.
Terrific.
Awesome.
Very much.
No, that works. So thank you so much, Paula, and welcome everyone. I see numbers are still, you know, ticking in. So we got some people joining us. And that's great. Tonight, we're going to talk about sexuality and the sacred self. That kind of frames us towards a healthy understanding of sexuality at times after abuse. A lot of the time in our world, sexuality is not talked about too well. And so one of the things that can really help with that, in my experience as a sexuality educator and trainer of people who work in the human service professions, that's like therapists and doctors, having an understanding about sexuality can really, really help give us language and have frameworks to work with things. So I'm really glad to be here today. Jerry, did you want to add anything before we jump in?
No, it really is a delight for us to be able to present something like this. We know that this can be scary for a lot of abuse survivors. And as Paula said, that we really urge you to take care of yourself. But basic knowledge about sexuality, I find in most of my work that I've done in the past 40 years, really, has is really such a important gap that we need to fill in gentle and astute and in very important ways, because when we don't know something and we've been abused, it feeds into really bad cycles of blame and shame. And so to me, this is a wonderful opportunity to really enter a new mystery, enter into something new that you might not have been exposed to before from your families or certainly from preaching in our churches. So I'm just delighted to be here to represent Georgetown and the global safeguarding program here at the Berkley Center. And we're just so delighted to collaborate with you, Paula, and your wonderful work in the Archdiocese. I really want to give a shout out to you and your national service that you continue to provide to the church in your incredible ministry to survivors. It's a model for other dioceses, and I consider it a great privilege for me to be able to collaborate with you, Paul, in a very special way tonight. And of course, with you, Mark, you know, just so that's all I'll say for tonight, but delighted to be here.
Awesome. Thanks, Jerry. And yes, definitely. Thank you, Paul, for everything you do. Let's get into some topics today. So today we are starting day one of a two-part series that we're doing. And today we're going to look at these topics of sexuality in a webinar format. That means you all can't see each other. And that means if you ask questions in the Q&A, it'll come up and then we can address them, you know, as time allows. But we do encourage thoughts and questions to go in there as well. We're going to talk about a framework for sexuality. Gives us an understanding and a language. And then we're going to have time for anonymous questions if you want to ask about this. And then at the end of today, we'll talk about, you'll get a link to a feedback survey to let us know about your experience and if there's anything you were missing or would like differently.
Paula, did you want to add something?
I was just going to add with the webinar format, and I'm not sure about this with webinars, but I think we are the only ones that can see the Q&A.
Okay.
So I just want to make that known.
Terrific. That's really important for anonymity and for privacy, folks. And so that's a really important point. Tomorrow, again, I think because we've had so many people sign up for this, which was tremendous, and I'm just awe-inspiring, quite frankly. We'll have the same sort of Zoom webinar format, but we'll also have a lot more time for discussion. And we really ask you, we'll be giving you some questions for your own reflection, prayer, discernment between now and tomorrow that we hope you spend some time being with, because there's so many different questions that so many of us are going to have about our sexuality, about our experiences, and really what does it mean for us as abuse survivors to be able to take back the sacred in our life, to take back our bodies, to take back what it means for us to be sexual, healthy creatures. We hope also it's going to be a great time just for us to build a sense of community and for us to know and hear the support from one another in a deeper way. And yet again, we really do want your feedback, and we'll have another feedback survey that we'll be sending to you. And we just really encourage you to fill it out real briefly. You'll get it at the end in a very quick link. And trust me, it's a very, very easy and very user-friendly feedback survey.
Awesome.
Paula?
I just wanted to say that the links are already in the chat. If they can access them, the links are already in the chat for that survey, for the form. Correct, Mark?
No, they came in later, so they're going to see them as we get to the slides, then we can put them in the chat.
I'm sorry. Mm-hmm.
Okay. No, that's all right. And so why are we having this seminar? Paula, did you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Well, to read this, sometimes sexuality is not taught well, and that leaves people ill-prepared to deal with matters of sexuality. And you know, those of us who are probably in my generation, a little bit behind me and far ahead of me, it was that way. People just didn't talk about it. And, you know, we had to learn it on the street, so to speak, from friends, you know, other kids, you know, when we were growing up and other children. And, you know, we're just ill prepared. We were very ill prepared to talk about it at all. And I think for years and years and years, and still in some cases, you know, the church does not address it as well. It's not comfortable with it. Let's say it's not comfortable with addressing it. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And hopefully those things are changing too.
Yes. Yeah.
In the way that we can do that. So about this 2-day seminar, what is it not? It is not a review of Catholic doctrine about sexuality, but rather,
You know, one of the things that I think is really important for us as we look at this particular topic, and it reminds me so much, we were talking earlier about the inspiration that Pope Francis has given us, that what it is really a pastoral approach to sexuality in the world today from a very faith-based Catholic viewpoint. But more than anything else, and I think this is the beauty of what Francis says when he says, all of us are children of God, it's really based on love. It's the gospel approach in regards to how we can understand and know and view these very complicated, very nuanced, very sophisticated issues that confront us every day. And so more than anything else, I hope and pray that we see this as a real pastoral approach. Before I go on, though, there are some questions in the Q&A, Paula, and apparently the chat is disabled. So if that could be enabled, that I think would be great. Okay. Just a practice.
If anybody knows how to enable the chat, that would be great.
I believe it's that little down carrot. You may have some authority to be able to change different settings on that.
I have.
If not, it would be in the webinar settings.
I have it. Show chat. Okay. How about now?
Like anything in life, this is a good learning experience for all of our viewers.
It is. It is.
So bear with us.
Right. And thanks for naming what it is you see and don't see. That's really helpful to us.
That's very helpful. Keep them coming, folks.
Good. All right, so what we're going to do today, what does today specifically look like? We're going to talk about a framework for understanding sexuality that's called the circles of sexuality. As a sexuality educator, I see a lot of people who are like, yeah, I know everything I need to know about sexuality. And then we do a semester-long course about topics in sexuality. They're like, I had no idea there was so much. So we're going to talk a little more about that here as well.
Exactly. And one of the key features I think that we hope we're able to portray are just the multiple layers of understanding that people often fail to grasp and fail to understand. So for example, what did your family teach you? What is your body telling you? What did your friends teach you? What do you know about various aspects of what does it mean to be intimate or not intimate? What are the types of intimacies? What are the sort of cultural ways that we all have been influenced for good and for bad? You know, so that, you know, we really want to enter the mystery of this topic, but we also want to be very shrewd about knowing that there are multiple layers that we need to dive into and just simply know.
And then we're going to talk about some questions to consider for tomorrow, for when we have our other Zoom discussion format. We're going to leave you with questions that you can ponder between tonight and tomorrow, and then we'll wrap up.
Terrific. And then hopefully, you know, we'll figure out the Q&A and give you a chance to just submit some anonymous questions tonight, so that you can feel a sense of safety and you can just simply submit them. One of the key ways to do that, by the way, is to simply do that in your own Q&A where you can say you want to hide or be anonymous. And so that's one feature. We encourage you to be in control of that feature in the Q&A. So if you don't want the question seen by anyone else, there is an option where you can submit your question anonymously, just to let you know that, okay? Just to be safe.
Awesome. Thank you, Jerry.
Sure.
And so one of the things that we do when we cultivate a space together is to make sure that we kind of have the same understanding about what's going on. And so as Paula said, and to reiterate, this content is going to be about matters of sexuality. And for some people that can be uncomfortable, or we haven't been given the right tools to be able to talk about or listen about that. And so to be mindful about what's going on for you. And especially in experiences of sexual trauma and having to manage feelings around abuse, sometimes self-care can be extra important on matters around sexuality. So please keep that in mind. And we want you to be safe, as Paula had mentioned before. And we also know that around sexuality, sometimes learning and listening and just absorbing can also be a challenge. And if that's the case, and if it is challenging for you, we invite you to be open and learn and try and understand things maybe you've never heard before. But again, if it starts to cross that line into starting to get more harmful, well then please step away, do what you need to do to take care of yourself.
Gosh, Mark, I think that's just so important and so well said by both you and Paula. I think for us in this particular presentation, because we're Catholics, we come from a Catholic framework, I think it's a chance for us to reclaim the sacredness of this mystery. And that's the invitation I hope that we're also able to put out there. In other words, is there a way, and that's sort of how we came up with the title, Sexuality and the Sacred Self. How can we take back how God created us as a sacred, wonderful creature? And to me, that's good Catholic anthropology. It's good Catholic theology. It's basic scripture. But also, as we see in Genesis and as we see throughout, scripture and our tradition, combining those together, we understand that there are going to be a lot of things that are very different, certain families, this was really taboo and or used against people in an abusive way. In certain families, it was just something that was talked about all the time. Most people learn about sexuality in very different ways, and we're going to talk about that. How you learned about it, how you experienced it, how you heard it talked about in religious schooling or in religious settings are really going to determine the unique mystery of who you are as God's beloved creature. And that's the most important mystery before us tonight. Can you begin to step back for a second and imagine yourself this night as God sees you, as God beholds you, as God's beloved? That message that Jesus heard in the Transfiguration, that message that Jesus heard in the baptism, you are my beloved, in whom I take great delight. That's where the sacred mystery has to begin in.
And when we do the Q&A, you can, of course, submit questions as they come up. But we're also going to have two different areas in tonight's webinar that is specifically designed to address the Q&A. We'll just take some time and look through it and make sure we get to those. And then the feedback forms, as Jerry mentioned, it's going to be a really easy link to go through. It doesn't track any information. It doesn't take your email. It is through Google Forms. And so it says it may have your email there, but it does not collect it. So we won't be having any of that information. You just submit whatever you think is helpful for us to know and whatever feels good to name in it. So thanks for that. And as we mentioned before, this language isn't only helpful to describe one's own feelings and experiences of sexuality, but it can also really help on a healing journey. Mm. In trauma research, this concept of having language and being able to name things can go a very, very long way. And so this framework about the circles of sexuality that we're about to get into can help give us not only an understanding of how sexuality is a lot more encompassing than what we maybe previously thought, but also can give us language to experiences that we maybe didn't know how to name before. Mm. Gary, did you want to add anything here?
Gosh, I think that's just so important, because all too often, you know, survivors of abuse struggle with the blame games, struggle with what technically is called the locus of control. In other words, depending on when abuse occurred, we know that individuals have little capacity to see something that's harmful happening to them as anything other than their own fault. And so all too often, and especially depending on the developmental stage where the assault or abuse takes place, we get into very distorted thoughts that lead to very, very escapist or sort of extreme ways of managing the feelings. So we go to, you know, extremes of either numbing it out or isolating it. So the black and white thinking that leads to black and white behavior, either or, acting out, and experiences that oftentimes, you know, seem incomprehensible to our consciousness. And so for us to begin to reclaim that is really about a very different and important healing journey.
So let's get into it. This model is called the Circles of Sexuality. It was designed by a sexologist in the 1970s and 80s. His name was Dennis Daly. And we've used it over the years in the world of sexuality education to help people understand a little more about sexuality and how we process and how we navigate it. One of the most recent citations. So for those of you who don't know, as a professor and college educator, one, I really work off the energy of the people. That's a little different in a webinar format. I'm talking to Paula and Jerry, and then my screen that has this up. So I also like to make sure to cite my sources, because that's really important. But the field of sexology is a large field that encompasses interdisciplinary research for sexual science. And this area, what we're going to talk about here, is a real quick snapshot of an overview that encompasses a whole bunch. So it's much like a teaser trailer for all the things that can encompass sexuality. Let's get into it. We see of these five circles that are kind of like in a circle in themselves, the first one we'll start with is called the circle of sensuality. And this is the physiological and psychological pleasures from one's own body and the bodies of others. And this is the things that we experience through our senses. Right? A very fundamental aspect of Catholic theology is that we are not a spirit trapped inside a dirty, bad body, right? Our body is the conduit through which we get to experience the world around us. Our body is the only way our soul gets to experience the material world. And we are inspirited bodies, to use Margaret Farley's language. And our senses and how these work in sexuality, taste, smell, touch, all of those come together to intersect with our own experience of sexuality. And it gives us pleasure. Sexual pleasure is a really important aspect of sexual theology that is oftentimes not covered in a lot of education. And then there's this concept of skin hunger. When I teach this to usually freshmen, sophomores at the college level, this is the word that kind of sticks out to them. First, we have questions about what skin hunger is. It usually entails being touched, right? Sexually, yes, but also in non-sexual ways, holding hands, a hug, a massage, right? Any type of touch. There are people with high levels of skin hunger, high needs. You know, these are those people that you see where they're like, I'm a hugger, and they just love to touch. And then there's people who have very low levels of skin hunger. Nope, I'm good. I don't need to touch. I'll just wave at you from across the room, right? We have different levels. And this, when we talk about couples counseling, is a really helpful frame for couples to say, oh, I have low levels of skin hunger and you want to be touched all the time. Now we can name it so we can talk about how to navigate that. Mm. Also in the circle of sensuality are orgasms or body sensations that we experience during sexual activity. And the way that bodies respond and what that means socially can oftentimes get really muddled, right? But the way that our body experiences sexual arousal, for those of you who are familiar with Masters and Johnson, they have this whole understanding of how arousal, this is where we get the term climax. It's from a graph, right? Where it goes up to the top and then resolution, things come downward, right? This is part of it. And then of course, fantasy, the sexual fantasies that we think about. One of the areas that I research is actually sexual fantasy and why and how those happen in our brains and what they look like. It's a fascinating field of study that we know very little about. But there's a lot of people saying a lot of things about how we know very little about it. Anyways, this is part of that psychological that we can get from our own body and the bodies of others. And then, of course, body image, or the way that we see our body and feel about our body. This usually when people bring this up, they're like, oh, that's weight. That has to do with how fat or thin I feel. And that does include body image, but it's actually a lot more. The concept comes from older neurological studies and understanding like our conceptualization of our hand and of our arm. But when we expand that to understanding of our sexuality, we see that our skin color, our hair type or hairstyle, or how big we are, how small we are, and how we exist in the world around us all influence our experience of sexuality and how others see us as well. Sherry, did you want to add anything?
Gosh, Mark, this is just so central and so important. When dealing with celibates, for example, and really trying to get them to understand the beauty of their identities and beauty of their persons, first and foremost, for them to understand that, you know, your body self first, as Freud would say, your first sense of self is a body self. And so often, I think I wish I had known so much of the chemical realities just associated with attraction, with senses, with pleasure, with all those neurological issues that you just mentioned. I think are so important for us to step back and just take stock of that. Look at this one circle of five that we're going to be talking about, how fundamental this is to know the physiological, psychological pleasure from one's own body, not in the sense of encouraging anything or anybody to do anything. Just, can you acknowledge what is there? Can you understand what it is to be in relationship with another body? You know, so both of those realities, I just think are so fundamental. Like, for example, the fact that, are you aware that you're attracted to someone because of a chemical reaction in you and the chemical reaction in the other? You know, that the pheromones, the release of pheromones is causing that attraction. Well, that sort of blows away so many different people that I've worked with in couples therapy and blows away all the various people that I've formed in seminaries and in houses of formation, because can you take seriously what your body is telling you? Now, this becomes really important because of those of us who've been abused, where you learn not to trust your senses, where you learn that what you feel, what may be pleasurable, is somehow being manipulated, which we'll get into before. But I just think this is so fundamental, so core, Mark, and it's really part and parcel of what we forget about the fact that, you know, God came in human form for a reason.
Absolutely. Thanks, Jerry. We also have the circle of intimacy. Intimacy is that experience of emotional closeness to another human being and having that feeling returned. This looks like sharing, right? Sharing is this experience of, okay, when I share something, there's feelings attached to it. There's a welcoming attached to it. There's a communication attached to it. Our feelings of liking or loving someone, what that looks like in our sexuality, right? The different kinds of love that exist. Feelings of vulnerability, intimacy, you can't have intimacy without vulnerability. So who do we open up to? Why? And how much do we want to open up to them? Right. And if someone betrays our trust, we suddenly don't want to open up to them anymore. We don't feel like we can be vulnerable. Mm-hmm. Because trust and risk taking are so intimately tied together. Right. You know, it's a huge risk that I'm giving you access to my bank account, but I trust you.
Thank you, Mark.
Right. Yes. Wait a minute. You got that number? But I do trust Jerry. This is great. When we do that emotionally, that can have what we oftentimes call high risk, high reward, right? The more you risk in being vulnerable, someone also has a high reward that can come with it. Also has a high risk, right? And that can be painful and hurtful, the way we navigate intimacy. And that affects our own experience of self. And so the way that we communicate with others about ourselves, self-disclosure, can I trust you with this? Do I feel like I can explain to you who I am so that you can be present with me? And a big one for sexuality is self-acceptance and self-love. Jerry, one of the things you mentioned earlier about seeing, hopefully in sometime in today, we can reflect a little more on how God sees us, right? Mm-hmm. And maybe for a little bit, get to see how God sees us. That reminds me of a prayer I heard once a long time in pastoral ministry school about when I'm having a really hard time with someone, I say, God, let me see but a glimpse of what you see, right? When I'm kind of annoyed with someone, I'm like, but this concept that God really loves someone, even if I don't like them. Mm-hmm. In self-acceptance, we have a thing that we do to ourselves called self-talk. And sometimes we have really negative self-talk. Mark, you're such an idiot. Why'd you say that? You shouldn't have. That if you hear someone talking like that to your friend, you're like, hey, that's my friend. Like, tone it down. Yet we might talk to ourselves that way. Mm. And so I oftentimes think of that prayer. God, let me see but a glimpse of what you see to give me a little more patience with myself. Right. And then, of course, communication. Communication about our feelings. You know, I'm feeling hungry. And that's giving me a short temper. And I think I need food. And then we can talk about this really important thing. But also sexual communication. This is what I've learned about my body. This is what I think you should know. These are some of the things that really don't work for me. These are the things that do, depending on how we approach others in our own sexual lives. Communication can be really, really important. Harry, did you want to jump in with anything?
Oh, gosh, Mark, wonderful examples, first of all, by the way, just really right on. In my work with couples for years, this is, of course, you know, where relationships will live and breathe, the ability to communicate well, the histories of past relationships and what was modeled in the home, regards to what I can do, what I can't do, how can I trust, how can I risk. Of course, I'm reminded of Brené Brown's research on the power of vulnerability and how central her research is to how core and counterculture for us to be vulnerable. And I think this is so much a gospel value now. If we could get away from the bravado of the sort of individualism that you see the cowboy marching off into the sunset on his own, you know, and come back to a sense of masculinity and humanity and femininity that really is about respecting the other in their vulnerability, that would be the most countercultural way in which we reclaim the sacred self, that we understand the sacred self, I think, through the ways in which, as abusive others, we have to reclaim how safe it is to tell people who we are. But most especially, I want to re-echo what you're saying, you know, most abuse survivors have those tapes that are just so destructive. I often tell or have told clients in the past when I was in a therapeutic setting, if you can just begin to stop that tape by saying, what's one way of thinking about myself differently right now? And see if I can get another tape beginning to roll. But I think this is so important for abuse survivors in particular to figure out how and where and when any one of us can begin to trust another because of just those maps that we've walked on before, where we've journeyed, have often led us into as the Samaritan says, oftentimes we've been beaten and left on the side of the road. So how do we begin to walk again? How do we begin to allow others to help us heal? I think that's the real challenge here for those of us who are abuse survivors.
Yeah. Thanks, Jerry.
Mark, there was a question on the last slide.
Yeah, I see that. And you know what? Thanks, Paula, for drawing attention to it.
Yeah, you can answer it later.
You know, I'll answer it right now in a short way. The question, everyone, was, does our sensuality change over time? Meaning what gives us sensual pleasure as a child or when we're younger, does that change as we become older, regardless of abuse? And the short answer is yes, absolutely. Sometimes there are things that, you know, stay constant. Some of the times they take up a large portion of our life and then suddenly change. We'll get into what that looks like later on when you do a bigger overview. But good question. Thank you. And thanks, Paula, for naming it. Mm-hmm. Our third circle is the circle of sexual identity. And this is a sense of who one is as a sexual person. This includes a sense of manness or womanness and to whom one is erotically, emotionally, and romantically attracted. That's just a lot of words to say, one's sexual orientation and gender identity, right? The way that we're attracted to people. Sexual orientation, you may have heard words like heterosexual, gay, bisexual, pansexual or asexual, not being attracted to anyone. Pansexual, being attracted to people regardless of external factors or gender. And then people's gender identity and gender roles. Identity being that sense of who we are internally. And then gender roles, how do we fill those in the world around us? What does the world tell us we need to do or be based on our gender. That has a huge impact on how we are as sexual beings. That includes what we do or think or how we interact with others. In a conversation about sexual, one's connection to our bodies and sexual pleasure, there was a guy who was talking about his nipples not being stimulated and having this conversation about what he was taught as a man and what that means for his body and how he can understand himself in a sexual way. Having those conversations and fleshing that out can really unlock a lot of doors that were previously closed off to us, because gender roles can really put blinders on the way that we live our lives. We also have biological sex or sex assigned at birth. This is oftentimes also called sex traits. People are like, oh, that's male and female. And there are also different ways of being intersex, because biological sex involves a combination of chromosomes, hormones, gonads, how bodies are formed. And there's several different ways, 29 specifically, of how bodies can develop in this way. And that will influence our own sexuality and our sexual identity. And then there's also relationship or behavior labels. You may have heard people talk about themselves as monogamous, right? They only, you know, date one person or they're married to one person. You may have heard the term polyamorous, right? People may have several loves, people that they love. You may have also heard the term celibate. If someone is a celibate person, that's a relationship or behavior label that people will use to talk about themselves and their sexual identity in different ways. But it's ways that we try and understand ourselves and communicate to others about who we are as sexual people. Jerry, did you want to jump in with anything?
Yeah, I think this is I think the caveats we said at the beginning of our conversation are that we're not contradicting anything in Catholic theology by simply pointing out what is. For some people, they use the term same-sex attraction rather than homosexual or dating orientation, and that they're dealing with that. I think what is important here is to begin to look at the complexity. And I love what you're referring to when I was studying at Johns Hopkins, and working in the human sexuality clinic there as a postdoctoral fellow. I was amazed at how little I did not know about just how many different people struggle with different biological realities from birth. And so it was a real eye-opener to me. I think obviously this gets into all the cultural wars that are out there. We're not really interested in doing that tonight. What we're interested in doing is really just describing what is there. And I think what is obvious is notice again how culture influences this, how the family influences this, how your own perceptions and your own sense of self influence this, that this becomes incredibly nuanced, incredibly layered, as we said from the beginning. And again, this gets into the richness of the mystery of who we are as sexual creatures.
Thanks, Jerry. And a quick note on this one, actually, from a sex educator standpoint, when people say, hey, what's your sexuality? They usually mean, what's your sexual orientation? Maybe they're referring to gender identity, but usually they want to know your sexual orientation. But we just went over a whole half of a circle about what sexuality is. And so when people are asking about sexuality, you can say, oh, do you mean sexual identity? And in that, what do you mean? Sorry, learning point, moving on. We then have our circle of sexual and reproductive health. When people say, sex education, this is usually what comes to mind. The facts, figures, and biology of the body and sexual and reproductive systems. And this is sometimes people have this in school for a whole year. Many times they just have it for 1 or 2 weeks. And many more times they might have it for one day and they actually just separate people and drop like really vague things for youth to try and understand. And then they're like, you're good to go. And then people are like, I'm not good to go. This is usually about anatomy and physiology. There's some really great, I use this one video in class often. BuzzFeed did a thing that says, if sex ed were taught like driver's ed, and they have a coach talking about the inside of an engine, and they make a whole bunch of these like different car analogies. It's really entertaining. I would highly suggest you watch it. Not right now, we're doing a thing, but later, it's very funny. Anyways, we don't oftentimes teach about anatomy and physiology well, especially when it comes to the ways that there are maybe racial differences. If you were to look up like sex organs of a body, like internal anatomy, almost all of those diagrams are of white people. That sends implicit messages, right? And the field of sex history, specifically around this part, has a lot of history around not exactly speaking to diversity of bodies. Mm. There's also this information about STIs, or sexually transmitted infections, formerly known as STDs, sexually transmitted diseases, formerly known as VD, or venereal disease, and before that, usually known as SIN. Up until the 1920s, physicians were still having the conversation about how these people might actually have these diseases because of their morality. And that's probably the reason they're suffering from sin. But so gaining understanding about this, about STIs and transmission, how they work, what that means. Contraception, how people try and not get pregnant or avoid pregnancy in different ways. Sexual behaviors, the things that people do. Usually in sex ed, they may vaguely mention penis in vagina sex and then leave it at that. But there's a lot of different ways that bodies can be sexual. And what that means is if we leave those out, we miss a lot of different ways that people can be safe doing other sexual behaviors and being able to understand the risks associated. Then pregnancy, abortion, and birth, concepts that most people know very little about. I once had a woman who was 24 and had two kids, and we were learning about bodies, and she goes, well, uterus, like, what's that? Like, why is a uterus important? And we're talking about this is where, you know, babies grow, et cetera, et cetera. And she goes, no, babies grow in the stomach. I know, I've had two kids. And the doctors would frequently tell me, your baby's in your stomach. What's this uterus thing you're talking about?
Wow.
And so even in the experience of pregnancy and birth, people still, we don't do a good job of educating people about these things and about bodies. Mm-hmm. And then of course there's sexual growth and development. How do we evolve as people throughout our lives? Not only what happens to our bodies and how our bodies hit puberty and what happens, but also socially, what is considered normal or not normal for different ways of feeling and doing or behaving sexually. When we don't have these conversations about sexual development, all of those things that are seen as like bad or devious don't have a platform to be able to talk about these things. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, what we call sexual difficulties. You may have heard the word sexual dysfunctions before. Under sexual functioning, how do bodies work? Remember that driver's ed versus sex ed video I was telling you about? In it, a student asks the question, they go, Well, what do I do if my car breaks down? And the guy goes, you don't need to know that. And that's how they teach about sexual dysfunction quite often. And this is concerning for a lot of sexual researchers because we're seeing a rising rate of sexual dysfunction in college. And that means people don't know how to deal with sexual dysfunction at, you know, generally young adult ages, because it's a thing that we're not taught about. We don't know how to navigate. And when we don't give people accurate information, the theories they come up with are rough. Have you ever talked to or heard a 12-year-old boy talk about what theories about sexuality are really true? They're usually not well informed. And so it's really good to have these conversations before people start making up their own reasons for why these things are the case. You want to add anything, Jerry?
Oh my gosh, where do I begin? What an important slide, what an important concept, what an important circle, friends, to begin to just take seriously all that's there. Again, we're not encouraging anything here. What we're saying is just being aware of it. I mean, look at what we all have to face when we watch the evening news in regards to the advertisements that are inundated, you know, with erectile dysfunction ads, you know, going on. Well, why are those ads there? Because there's a need, and you know, these advertisers wouldn't do this. So, I mean, we're bombarded with these realities, and yet, where's the context? And I guess the reflection I had also, Mark, is that isn't it interesting that here we are in the third circle? And we're talking about what most people in education get, you know, so in the schools or if courses, if you've had these courses, when in reality, look at the two previous circles then that were never addressed, you know, long before we're putting the basics of what is anatomy class or physiology class or, you know, the sex education classes that some people get. And again, what's striking is the last image you used is most people we know, and having done umpteen different workshops and seminaries and in houses of formation, it's confirmed every single time that all too often the most basic knowledge about this reality happens with those experts on the playground or the alley who are 12 years old. Now, that's the sad fact of what we as a society and we, you know, in our own families have failed to do. And canon law says that the family really has to be the first teacher of sexuality, you know, and research after research after research says that somehow that's not being done. And so when that's not being done, there's a huge information gap. There's a huge way in which then you then put abuse or trauma on top of a lack of knowledge of basic, you know, functions, sexual functions for people who are involved in appropriate relationships. That's really pretty scary to me. And why, when would someone not be able to trust, as we talked about in the previous slide? Why then would people not be able to communicate? Because they don't know what's going on in a mind. And that's why I think this is so fundamental and so critical.
Yeah, knowing, very important. There was actually, another sex ed story. I had an 18-year-old young man in my class, and he said, well, babies, why do we need to know about vaginas? Babies are born out of buttholes. They come out of your bum. And everyone in class thought he was joking for that first second. They were like, ha, 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 this is hilarious. But then they all looked and he was dead serious. And what had happened was he'd changed schools from fourth grade to fifth grade. In his old school, they covered sex ed in fifth grade. In his new school, they covered it in fourth grade. And then at home, someone didn't want to have the conversation with him. How does that baby come out? Oh, it's gonna, you know, come out of my bum.
Wow.
And he was 18. And so when we keep information from people about how bodies, the bodies that God created, work, what are we robbing them of in terms of understanding how to interact with other humans? Paula, did you want to add anything?
No, I just think that's so important, what you just said.
Yeah.
You know, that we don't have an appreciation for our bodies and what God has created as good, mm-hmm. you know, and all that was stripped of us if we were abused, all that was kind of stripped away, and it takes a long time to get that back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you. And lastly, our fifth circle is the circle of sexualization. And this is the use of sexuality to influence, manipulate, and control others. And a lot of times people think immediately what comes to their mind here is rape and coercion and sexual assault and sexual harassment. And that is very true. Those would fall into this circle and can be really harmful aspects of sexuality. There are, however, some more positive ones that fall into this circle as well. We sometimes try and use our sexuality to influence people when we flirt with them. We literally try and smile at people and touch their arm enough so that they're like, "Oh, I like this person. They're nice, right? I want you to like me. So I'm going to smile and be nice and flirtatious, right? In ways that, you know, influence other people's decisions about it." Seduction also works with the way that people navigate their sexuality to try and seduce or have sex with people that they love and trust. Advertisements and the media. This is a one-way mass communication where we just see it and absorb it. People oftentimes use sexuality to try and get people to buy things, right? As we mentioned before, rape, coercion, sexual harassment, sexual assault, and also withholding sex, the way that we commodify sex in our relationships. You know, "Oh, well, we're not gonna do any sex things until you do the dishes." Like, that's, you know, "He hasn't done anything for me yet." So that is withholding sex, right? The way we commodify that in our relationships and what that does to our relationships when we do it that way. Then, of course, coercive incest, or oftentimes sex between family members in Jerry, is there anything you wanted to add to this one?
No, I just think this is where, you know, so many of us as trauma survivors really live, in the sense of the coercion, the manipulation, and the influence and control of others. But I like how you started that. Notice what was normal was stripped away for many trauma survivors and manipulated. And so to me, that really rings true in the sense of, you know, that many of us are going to experience normal realities, and in the extreme, they become pathological. And so to me, this is really important. And again, I just want to reiterate, as you do here, how much our culture influences and has a very big say in what we believe about ourselves and others, and sort of the body ideal versus, you know, who we are. And so that's a constant sort of barrage, I think, that we get. And the final point, I think, is, you know, so often people confuse this aspect with the abuse of power that goes on in so many sexual assaults and in abuse, you know, and I think that has to be really made clear here in this final fifth circle, that, you know, we're really talking about the misuse of power and the abuse of power, and how people can be seemingly joking, but you know, quite abusive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thanks, Jerry. And great question. Is sexualization where pornography is talked about? Oftentimes, people will talk about pornography in sexualization as using sexuality to influence or manipulate others. But then there's also different components of pornography, right? Where we looked at the other circles where sexual behaviors were part of them. Sometimes they'll incorporate different sensations into pornographic material. And so then that would fall into the circle of sensuality, right? So it depends on the way that you're talking about pornography. But most often people will start here when talking about pornography, yes. Good question.
And it also that goes back to, I think your point is well taken, Mark. It goes back to also the fantasy aspect that we talked about in the previous circle. You know, that's what pornographers live on in many ways. You know, it's not just the physiological sort of realities, but, you know, they play with the what ifs. And this is a major issue, as we know, in young population and therefore in seminaries and therefore in married life this day, that pornography is a major, major issue that confessors hear about, and that families struggle with, and that young people struggle with. And so, again, this is really an important way to reclaim a sacredness to our sexuality and really be countercultural in that way. Mm-hmm.
Do you see the question, Mark? Is sexualization where pornography is talked about?
Yes. I mentioned about how people will start here with pornography, but that it is oftentimes talked about in different ways.
Right. Yeah.
Thanks, Paula. Mm-hmm. And so let's now take a step back to this broader model. We have, of course, sensuality, intimacy, sexual identity, sexual health and reproduction, sexualization. In the middle of all of those, we all have our values associated with each one of them. This is how this should be. This is how I feel about this. Values will permeate on each one of those circles, and that entire structure exists within culture. Meaning, sure, your, you know, national culture, right? US, Japan, Germany, you know, different places have different national cultures, but we also have subcultures, right? In a lot of our experiences, Catholic culture is a very, you know, unique experience. And then if you even break it down into subcultures, right? You have different, like, you know, white Catholic spaces, Black Catholic spaces, Ethiopian Catholic spaces. You have, you know, smaller and smaller experiences, but all of them have cultural nuances, have values that people will put on these different things. And where will we see those? We'll see them come up in our heads when we hear a thing and we're like, this is what I think about that. I have values associated with it. Well, where do those values come from? Are those things you feel, and why do you feel them? Or are they just things that you never really re-examined to think a little more about? The reason I bring this up is because in my classes, we start with, what do you all know about this topic? And then people say, you know, whatever they say about X, Y, or Z. And then I say, okay, we're going to come back to this. We do our little education session. And then at the end of it, we say, okay, now, what do you know about this topic? What do you think about it? Does any of that information change the way you might have thought about X, Y, or Z? And oftentimes, learning more about it can influence the way that we understand something, the way that we see it, and it helps us gain ownership of and flesh out our values more, right? And this is one of the great things about doing academic work. You're kind of on this, you see where people have not added different things, and you start talking about it and fleshing it out more. That's on the edges of Catholic theology, on the edges of sexuality research, and all of these different areas. And the world of sex research can give us a lot of really great information to understanding ourselves and how we work within our Catholic faith around that. for example, in you know, the circle of sensuality, we talk about orgasms. And there's a concept in the world of sex research called the dual control model, or the way that we experience physiological arousal, the way our bodies will respond sexually to something that we may not think is sexual. And when that is not the same, sometimes we see something and we're like, ooh, we're sexually aroused, body gets aroused. Sometimes we see something, we're like, that's not arousing, but then our body does get aroused and we're like, body, what are you doing? This is what we call arousal non-concordance. Why is this concept important? This concept is important because in a lot of sexually coercive scenarios, our bodies do things that we might not have wanted them to do. And that can really influence, well, then what does that mean, right? In a lot of legal settings, people will use a body's physiological response as groundwork for consent. And that is not true. And we now have a language and a framework, arousal non-concordance, as a way of understanding that. And so there's a lot of different aspects of sex, sexual science and sex research that can really help us make sense of ourselves as people. And in terms of a Catholic framework, how we then relate to ourselves and relate to others and relate to God when we know that these things are actually not unique to us, but normal for humans to experience. What does it mean? How do we feel about that? What do we do about that? Are all important questions to sit with. Jerry, did you want to add anything, Paula?
If I may, I think that this is the essence of what I hope we understand, both in the cultural perspective, but in the subcultural perspective of how is a Catholic ethic the ground of our sort of talk of sexuality. How's that relational? How's that, you know, coming back to a whole body of teaching that really is core to who we are as believers? Secondarily, I think what you just mentioned, I know in talking to other trauma therapists, I know having led trauma groups, I know having done this work for a really long time, this is really so important that, whether in a court deposition or in testimony, that somehow a victim of assault or abuse, felt something pleasurable and somehow they feel that therefore they wanted it. And I think that really needs to be talked about in the sense of that just because, you felt something that was not in your control. And see, this is why knowledge of the body is so important. Just because you felt something is not in your control does not mean you gave consent. They often then lay that blame game on themselves. Well, my body obviously, wanted something like this because I had an erotic experience, as opposed to the fact that no, that was a physiological response to stimuli, And I think this is a struggle I see time and time again. So this is really important to begin to get our heads around, but also to begin to watch the blame game here with physiological reactions as opposed to consent. I don't know. If I'm being clear in that regard, but I hope I am.
Thanks, Jerry. I appreciate it. Let's take a breath and a pause here to address any questions people might have. Go ahead and throw them in the chat if there's something you want to bring up or you have a question about. Maybe you frequently have access to certified sex educators, maybe you don't. Now would be a time for you to ask either anything about the circles or maybe something about sexuality that maybe you weren't sure about. And if it's a easily answerable question, we will. If it's a massive one about why are we sexual beings, I don't know if we can get to that answer. That's a bit of a broad one, but
if you just have any reactions, is this helpful? What were your reactions to the sort of thinking about this within the complexity of multiple interlocking circles? I love that image, Mark, because it really shows the interrelationality, the sort of ways in which these realities function within each other and yet separately. And so I just love that image. And so it's so helpful in just beginning to understand and beginning to really give a visualization for what this might mean for us, in many ways.
Mm-hmm. Here's a question. Is it common for victims of sexual abuse as a child to react with asexuality, then bloom into their sexuality?
Thanks for reading that question, Paula. That's a really good question about the intersection of abuse and sexual orientation, right? Or the way that we experience sexuality. Asexuality specifically as an identity has oftentimes been pathologized, meaning that we oftentimes throughout history have said, oh, if you're asexual, that means something's wrong and we need to fix you so that you can feel sexual attraction again. And that's really a concept that a lot of people in sexual science are moving away from. Why? Because we're seeing that it actually can just be an orientation that just exists. That being said, to reiterate what Jerry mentioned before about how bodies are so individual, this mystery of sexuality, can sexual abuse influence the way that we look at sexuality within ourselves? And can that mean that our brains have shut off certain parts of our body that will respond sexually? That absolutely can happen. Yes. Mm-hmm. And that means that can change over time. Absolutely. One of the things about that culture picture where it's all the things, all the circles surrounded to say that this is culture, those don't only just exist now where you are today and that's it, right? They're going to change as people get older. People's sexual orientation, people sometimes talk about that changing. They're like, you know what? I was interested in these types of bodies or people when I was younger, and now I feel differently about that. All of these aspects that we mentioned here can definitely change, and many of them should, right? Being able to communicate about our feelings, I hopefully can do that better now than I could when I was 5, right? But I don't know, I'll ask my friends and I'll report back. But all things about this concept of sexuality usually do develop over time. Even if it's, one's gender identity as a, you heard the word cisgender people or someone who's not transgender, someone who is assigned male at birth, for example, and then grows up and says, yes, I'm a male, I'm a man. That's usually what we talk about as a cisgender person. But that person may have a very different understanding of what kind of man they are at 18 and what kind of man they are at 89. Mm. And an 89-year-old man says, well, what should men be? And they say, well, they should be strong and they should be able to lift heavy things. And I'm 89. And maybe I can't. That can influence the way that I feel about my gender identity.
Absolutely.
But I'm rambling a little bit, but
yeah, that's okay. No, there's that old adage that, no, it's very helpful, Mark. Very, very helpful. I think you're answering a lot of the questions. And thank you so much for so many of you who are just being so gracious in really how this is helping. One of the key things, that I've always said is when you meet one abuse survivor, you meet one abuse survivor, because the mystery of sexuality is so individual. And I also believe that over time, and I love your image that you've used, sexuality can be healed through trusting relationships. But it's, notice what it is, it's in relationship. And it's the relationships that oftentimes heal the trauma survivor, you know, where they're able to risk, where they're able to be vulnerable, they're able to communicate, that they're able to feel safe. And that takes time, and again, the trauma survivors, one of the key aspects here is, in answering one of the other questions, is how do you sort of view what has happened to you and when the abuse has occurred will determine your capacities to respond and to think differently about yourself. So for example, someone abused prior to 12 or 14 will deal with it very differently than someone, who has different developmental capacities. And so think about that physically too. And also what we know is the intensity, the duration, the frequency, and the betrayal of trust that occurs in the abuse experience will determine often how well or how difficult the recovery is for that individual. And so I hope that helps answer some of the questions that have come. But really wonderful feedback from lots of different folks.
Yeah, thanks. Appreciate that, Jerry. And I also want to say, I'm not sure we'll get to all of these questions, but every one of them is really meaningful. And I want to thank you all for your vulnerability here. Some of you have been naming some really important and heavy things. And so a couple quick ones that I do want to answer before we move on. We still got another couple minutes of things. About one question about how true is it that a physically abused person would later become sexually abusive? That's actually a misuse of statistics when it comes to people who perpetuate sexual abuse. And so the short answer for that one is, if that's a concern about oneself, that's a really good thing to talk about with someone else. But it's not a direct correlation. It doesn't mean that when people are abused, they will definitely go on to abuse someone else. But rather, the question should be, what does abuse teach us? And how can we unlearn the things abuse have taught us? Mm. Right? What modes of communication have I learned were normal, but actually are harmful to others? Right. And this is a question that a lot of people just keep asking ourselves. Right.
Now, it's really critically important to mark that point that, that survivors of the data is really clear that the overall majority of survivors, you're talking 85, 90% of survivors of abuse never end up abusing anybody sexually. And that's how staggering the data is. And in my own research with priest offenders, it was very clear that even those offenders, only 30, 35% were ever sexually abused. So it disproves the myth right away. Now, did they experience trauma in their background? Most, yes. But that's different. And again, the field of trauma is learning so much more every day. But this is really, of this we can be certain. But thank you for saying that, Mark.
Yeah, thanks. Another question on asexuality. If sexual feelings don't exist, does that mean it was abuse? No, that's not the case. That has been a thought historically. People thought, oh, if someone doesn't have sexual feelings, it's because they were abused. That's not true, not necessarily. Jerry.
No, I was just gonna mention one of the questions.
Yeah.
I think a lack of sexual education largely contributed to my sexual abuse, so much so that it feels overwhelming to take responsibility of the sexual education of my children. However, I think it is very important to break this cycle of lack of education. What resources can guide me? What resources do you suggest for parents? And any words of wisdom for navigating how triggering sexual education is?
Mm-hmm. So important. Great question. There are a lot of sex educators who work specifically with parents and how parents talk to their kids. One of them is named Dr. Lex. That's Dr. period L-E-X-X. And she writes children's books, and she has 3 kids of her own, and talks about how to communicate with children about sexuality in ways that specifically break it's not family curses, but it's like the ways that families teach you how to talk about things, and you want to kind of break those cycles.
Thank you.
Those mm-hmm. cycles of communication. And you can be that person. So one, I want to applaud your desire to do that differently and look up those resources. Dr. Lex is a great resource. I think her name is Dr. Lex Sex Doc online somewhere. She runs an intimacy institute and workshops on that. Words of wisdom for navigating how triggering sexual education is, being gentle with yourself, right? Always be aware of what it is you're feeling. Take some time to think through and talk about with a trusted individual. What's going on with you? How does it feel? Why does it feel that way? And is it something you want to do or feel differently about? And if so, imagine what you would like that to look like. But definitely taking time to process those things. Paula, Jerry, any other thoughts on that?
No, I think what you've said is just such wisdom, Mark, that when we are triggered, and it sounds like teaching sexuality would be triggering for this particular person, I think the more help you can get in that regard, the more coaching you can get in that regard, either from a therapeutic perspective or, you know, from outside sources, like you have mentioned, Mark, I think it's really important. That's why I just, for trauma survivors, there are multiple and multitudinous triggers that we face on a regular basis, isn't it? And parents face that in much more detail. And so having a good spouse to talk to about this, having the ability to vent what is and is not happening at the moment, sort of places the past in the past, and you're able to live in the moment. And also that vulnerability, if well in check and if processed well in therapy, can actually be just an amazing source of healing and health for your children. But what I want to come back to what Mark said there, though. The desire to break the family secret and family cycle is of God. And that is sacred. And hang on to that desire, because that's hope. Things will be different.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Jerry. I want to be cautious of our time. We got about 6 minutes left, and I want to make sure everyone gets the stuff before they leave, right?
Okay.
So thank you, everyone, for those questions.
And we can easily get back to some of these tomorrow night, folks, so stay tuned. You know, that we have a whole other evening and we can get back to these questions. Life is about being unfinished. Sorry that we're not going to get to all the things tonight. That's why we planned 2 nights, though. So be comfortable in the unfinishedness.
Okay. I found this. I belong to Facebook, Ron Rollheiser's Facebook page, and he sends out a daily reflection. And his books are just tremendous as well. So this is what I received the other day. And it was so appropriate with this topic coming up. So we're going to read it for you. Do not be afraid of your own body, of its goodness, its sexuality, its pleasures, its tiredness, and its limits.
It's the only one you've got in any case.
Be friends with it.
Don't punish it, don't spoil it, don't denigrate it.
It's a church, and it's the medium for which you love and communicate.
Give it enough rest, exercise, respect, and love.
What we're really going to start talking about here are the ways in which the mystery of our own spirituality and sexuality is formed. So we talked about before the way you and I were touched early on, how frequent that touch was, what your parents experienced when they birthed you, how welcomed you were, how ready they were for you, often determines the ways in which they can attach and you can attach to them. What we see so clearly and so wonderfully is that sexuality ultimately comes from this wonderful bond of mother and child, of father and child, of parents and children, and of the family itself. And to understand the spirituality of sexuality, I think, like most of us today in the Catholic faith, we need to reclaim the sacredness of that space of family. We need to reclaim that mystery. And that in that uniqueness, you know, there are many generalities are just going to fail us, you know. So much like Mark was saying, you know, what were you taught about, you know, what to touch and what not to touch? So that skin hunger that was physiologically already there, predisposed in your sort of biological makeup, then gets modeled, doesn't it, in certain behaviors that were there. What do we see in the messages on the internet? What do we see in the messages that come on our screens every day and in the screen that you're having right now? How do you filter that? How do you sort of take back the experience of computing? There's a wonderful phrase called contemplative computing, which I want to throw out there in the sense of how can you begin to engage with the internet, begin to engage with what's happening here so that you can take back what that is. How do you deal with how society views beauty of both men and women? How do you understand your own body in relationship to the body ideals that are thrown at us on every commercial, in every magazine cover, in every supermarket, in every ad that we see? How do you begin to become countercultural in that sense and come back to that sense of self that is sacred? You know, that sense of self that really goes back to who we are and how we function in our own body. I think what that means is that there's a rich cultural expression of that, you know, from the indigenous, from the Hispanic, from the Black Hispanic, from the white Hispanic, from all the various range of Asian and multicultural realities. How do we experience that sense of the sacred through different cultures? That's a really important question. The culture of our own upbringing, the culture of the family we're trying to create, but also the cultures that surround us and that inundate us on a regular basis. That really dictates, I think, the multi-faith and interfaith realities. You know, so what are the images that we have of our body and the body that is sacred that allows us to see in the other the beauty of the face of God and the reality of the face of God that stares back at us? How do we accept that and how do we sort of integrate that? Again, these are questions for you, for your own sort of reflection, prayer, discernment for tomorrow. And the key question I want to sort of leave you with is, so what were you preached from the pulpit? What messages were you told about how beautiful your body is, how beautiful sexuality is, how beautiful this whole topic is, and how the spirituality of sexuality is essential to how we can walk together as a synodal church, how we can walk together equal one with one another on a journey of faith and in a journey of each other's bodies, one next to one another? These are multiple layers of sexuality that we need to consider. So simply put, what type of sexual education information did you receive? So looking ahead to tomorrow, maybe spend some time reflecting on that. What were you taught and who taught you that?
And then when you look at what you were taught about sexuality, what are some things you appreciated about that? What did you actually appreciate learning? Usually there's something that might have sat well. And what about some ideas that were harmful? In your years that you've lived so far, what maybe didn't go so well that you wish you would have learned differently? What do you wish you were taught in your sexuality education that could have changed that? We heard some of that in the Q&A today about a lack of sexuality, maybe not helping. Well, what would have helped? What would have been better? Consider these questions, and we can move on to talking more about them tomorrow in a more Q&A format. Less from us, more from all of us. Earlier, you'd heard me mention the concept of arousal non-concordance, or when our bodies respond to things that we don't want them to respond to. If you're interested in learning more, there's a talk by a sexologist named Dr. Emily Nagoski. We'll put the link in the chat to the TED Talk, but I also want to give a preface where she is going to talk about pretty explicit bodily reactions and how bodies work. And she does talk about using explicit language, what goes on in bodies, but she frames it in a way that's oftentimes helpful for people to understand a little more about arousal non-concordance and what that means. I'll go ahead and put it in the chat. Jerry, Paula, did you want to add anything on this?
Just that, you know, I saw it and it can be very triggering. So just take a lot of deep breaths, but the information is really good.
And I want to concur with Paul. I saw two, and I recommend it, particularly though for those who had trauma experiences in which they may have had experiences that were out of their control that they did not want to have happen. I think this, to me, was very freeing, but it is explicit, and we really want to warn you about that. But I think it's very valuable if you're up for it. But again, please take care of yourself with all of that.
Yeah, thank you both. And so tomorrow, we're going to talk more about some of the questions and reactions. There were some we didn't get to in here, but they were really, really good questions. Thanks for naming them. I'm glad to hear that all of this would have been great to grow with. Glad to hear that. And as we move out of tonight and into tomorrow, we're going to put the evaluation in the chat. If you could, that would be great. If you could click on that and fill that out, that's the second link, the one that says forms, https://forms. And let us know how it went, how you feel about it, maybe some hopes you have for tomorrow, things that can help. Any other thoughts you both want to add?
No, I know there's some people who are wondering how they can get more resources. We're going to talk about that a bit more tomorrow night, and this is recorded, so you will be able to have the slides. People have asked for the slides, and you know they really want to go back and look at that. Please know that we really appreciate you being here and your time and just the sacredness of who you are. The courage it takes to really do something like this. So be well and be blessed.
Yeah, I just want to reiterate a thank you, and thank you for all your comments in the chat and in the Q&A, and hope you can join us tomorrow night.
Although there's a person who says the chat was disabled and they can't access the forums. And so I wonder if
you could... Mark, can you transfer those to the Q&A? Possibly.
That's a great question. Thanks, everyone. Let's see. Answer live.
We want to hear from you.
Select all.
All right. So I did answer something. Did that come through on the chat? The anonymous, I can't see the chat. It says disabled. Answered with the Google Forms link. People see that now. Oh yeah, Ologies is a good podcast too. Thanks. Yeah.
Maybe we can just send it out also to the attendees, Paula, afterwards.
Yeah, I will.
Okay, great.
Terrific. Thank you all so much.
All right, thank you. Have a good night.